Good afternoon and welcome to the final summit today, final summit session today on the role of spouses in family enterprise. I am delighted to be joined this afternoon by Kim Schneider-Malek from the Family Enterprise Alliance in the United States of America. She's also the adjunct professor at the University of Louisville College of Business in Denver in Colorado. Kim, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Nice to see you and nice to see everyone.
Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Could you just give us a little bit of intro into who you are and how you've got to where you are today in the world of family business?
Yeah, sure. Hi, everyone. So I am both a second generation practitioner serving family enterprise. I went 25 years ago, I went in business with my father, who was a chartered accountant, who was a CPA, and said, you know, there's this family dynamic that goes on with people in a business and people around the people in the business who own the business. And he started a practice. And then in 1997, I joined him in his practice and took this journey. At that point, I was only a second generation family member. And along the way, I ended up having a gentleman call me and say, hey, do you know of any businesses that are in succession but don't have a successor that might be in the wine industry that might be interested in bringing me on and developing me as if I were a son? And I told him first that he was crazy, and then I married him. And so that is how I met my husband and how I got my second role as an owner spouse. Is he ultimately really did find that business, believe it or not, through a leadership group that he was involved in, where he found a gentleman who wanted a son. He was estranged from his own son and was looking for the dynamic of a family business. And so he brought my husband on, and they did an arrangement where over the years he did an earnout and became owner of that business. So I evolved into the role that I am speaking about today, although I do have those 25 years of background in working with families through their journeys of continuity and succession and transition. And Paul, I always say I'm between the couch and the court. So if a family needs deep intervention and therapy, I will find them those resources. And I'm not a legal advisor or a financial advisor. I help the families rise as an entity inside of the enterprise and strengthen through governance and family communication. Okay. So that's my background. And I also have spent the last 20 years both at the University of Denver and now at the University of Louisville in the Masters of Business programs, teaching family enterprise and family business management. So that's a little bit of background on me, coming from the sunny Colorado in the middle of the United States.
Fantastic. Well, you've got a good background, I think. You're steeped in background and history of family business. So I'm looking forward to the session. Today, we're talking about specifically the role of spouses in family firms, Kim, aren't we? And it's not something that's often talked about. It's one of those kind of almost taboo subjects that's kind of alluded to and then put on the back burner and people don't really address. So really interesting to see what you've got to say this afternoon around the topic.
Sure. Yeah, it's a fascinating topic. And one, not only is it near and dear to my heart, and when you take the journey in your own pair of shoes, you understand that what you say as a practitioner is sometimes academic and not so easy to follow and to implement. And so, that's why I'm glad to join you and thrilled to launch into this presentation. And at any time, please, all of you who are participating on this particular webinar in this time space, please participate as you will, ask questions as you go.
Brilliant. So anyone that wants to ask a question is more than welcome to do through the chat function, and I will pose those questions to Kim during the session too. So Kim, over to you, and we will interrupt as and when we have some thoughts.
Okay, great. So first, what I want to talk to you all about is I hope you can see there's some micro text on this. Paul, are you able to see this chart on here?
It's perfect.
To some degree, good. So I want to put in context the way that I think of enterprising families, and different than the family enterprise, because the family enterprise is the three circles model we always see. We're business forward and ownership forward. And what we're going to talk to you about today is the enterprising family at the center, at the core of all things inside of this world of family enterprise. And there are various players who participate in that. And we, those of us listening and trying to understand the universe of the owner spouse and spouse in general, we'll take a look at what that is. And so if you look at the red center box, the enterprising family itself comes together. And if you think about what the word enterprise means, and maybe even take a second and look on your phone at the definition of enterprise, but it's the undertaking of a difficult endeavor in pursuit of something, using your resources, applying them in a way that yields a result, right? That's enterprise. It's not always business. It's not always wealth. It can be initiative of an idea. It can be all of those things. And so from inside of a family, there is this value of enterprise that says, let me go out and build something, create something bigger, better, faster, more efficient. Let me own that and control that. So the enterprising family says, okay, we are going to put our resources in service into a structure that we own. We're going to create a plan. It's usually in our heads or at the dinner table to go forward. And we will, in most cases, for those of us on the call, we will end up creating a business, a structure that allows us to play the game of business within our enterprising family. We often use the term entrepreneurship on a global scale, meaning it could be a fifth or 10th generation business that's entrepreneurial. How do you take the resources that you have, put the enterprising energy into them, and pursue a way to invite the universe into your space, into this gold circle, if you will, this gold hexagon rather, in a way that allows them to exchange with you. And usually the exchange in the commercial world is you create something, you sell something, they pay you for that something, and then you become a growing entity, a growing operating company, usually started as the idea, sometimes in the garage, sometimes in the kitchen. Sometimes it's grown to a multi-billion pound entity, multi-billion dollar entity. But that operating company then expands. And as it expands, we say to ourselves, how do we make sure that we not only own, but that we control what we own? And that is when we introduce this concept of governance. When we say, sometimes just legally, how do we put a board in place? And sometimes intentionally, how do we put a framework for decision-making control in place in our enterprise, in our business, and both the business and the family? So we call that governance, just to use to overview the language we'll use. And then on the next area is wealth. When we succeed at doing that over the generations, over the years, we create what we often think, if you look at this financial world word, usually we think wealth is where everything is at in terms of money. But what we'll talk about as we evolve into this, the role of the spouse, is all the different kinds of wealth that contributes inside of this gold hexagon frame that allows a family to pursue for themselves and society a greater good and a greater sense of happiness by using their resources. We need capital, we need wealth. And then just for context, as we have seen over the generations, as wealth grows, then we scratch our heads and say, what other structures do we need to put in place consciously, intentionally, evidently, to manage that wealth? In addition to being over here managing the family business, how do we structure the family wealth? And some of you may have a family office, or some of you have heard of a family office, or some of you maybe never have heard about it, but you probably have one embedded inside of your business where the people with numbers knowledge and finance knowledge help you take care of the investments that you have and the real estate that you have and grow them in a way. And then lastly, on this enterprising family chart, we have the Family Foundation. And the Family Foundation may be an actual structure of how do we place in service for social impact, a structure that allows us to give some of our wealth away or a significant amount of our wealth away, and not just our money, but our time, our capital, our intellect, our social, socio-emotional wealth that will let others in our societies and our communities rise because of our success. So that's that structure for all of you is one that I like to work with when I think, where do I fit? If I put my hat, not as a consultant, but if I put my hat on as a spouse of owners and as a third generation vocational spouse in my husband's family, where do I fit in all of this? And it struck me one day that it's quite evident that all these structures serve the success of today and the future and tap into the legacy. What did someone before me do to get my family here? And what can my family do to get my grandchildren's family into their future as an enterprising family, as a derivative of this family that I call mine? And I was trying to find where is my role. And I had a client struggling saying, I create the robust welfare of the system on this chart, and there is no role for me. There is no defined role that I play that allows me to see myself actively on this chart. So that's how the topic came to be, realistically for me. I just want to jump in for a second. On the family enterprise capital, this wealth cycle hexagon over here, because that is where I believe that owner spouses really get involved in contributing to the value of the family enterprise as a member of the enterprising family. So there is a form of wealth, financial wealth, which is here number four, is money, is currency, is recognized by the greater world as the bigger the number, the more you have, as a way you can exchange and create exchange. But all of these other eight forms of capital are what families at their dinner table, families in their home, families on their vacation, families raising children do. And why spouses play such a critical role in generating, quote, wealth for enterprising families. So there's a concept called socio-emotional wealth. And Paul, I'm just going to ask you, have you done any programs around socio-emotional wealth yet?
No, not yet. No. Yeah. Not focusing on that as a core subject, no.
Okay. So when we think, if you just reflect for a moment, when we think about how we as enterprising families create wealth so that we can expand those hexagons and expand our presence and our footprint and our impact. In order to get to that financial wealth, we have to work with families from not just the pocket, but from the head and the heart. And the socio-emotional wealth is the non-financial capital created inside of families by families that create flow and opportunity and threat inside of enterprising families. And who creates the influences, at least in the nuclear family? And I once had somebody say, did you just mean nuclear? Because their family was going through great conflict. But inside the nuclear family, the socio-emotional wealth is generated from the heart, through the mouth of communication, in the head. It's how we communicate, it's how we bond, it's how we unite, it's how we bridge divides, it's how we build a reputation, it's how we live out our ambitions, it's how we send our kids to school and expect them to participate in a system that's educational. It's how we feel and it's how we express. So the socio-emotional wealth also is how we end up being committed to the long-term horizon of family enterprise. And so who influences that socio-emotional wealth? It isn't just the legal owners of the family enterprise. It's both parties or three parties, however your family unit is constructed. It involves the spouse who influences the social and emotional growth of the individuals who are participants inside of that. I have a chess display here, inside of that game of family enterprise. So the socio-emotional wealth is a form of capital that is essential, that is controlled in terms of quantity and size, if you will, by all parties in a family unit, not just by descendants of an ownership family. So spouses play a role in that. The human capital, spouses play a role in that. How do you develop the individual human beings to show up and be present in an enterprising way on behalf of the structure that we just showed, and to bring their talents? How do we develop those talents? And the next being intellectual also ties into the human. Who are the people? What are their talents? How do we guide them to understand the learning process? Because every enterprising family and every family business is a learning organization. Who is it that's influencing how kids learn, what they learn, where they go to learn, how involved they get in their learning? That's parents. That includes the spouse, not just the descendant of ownership. I'm going to skip over financial capital for a second, because there's so much obvious about that. And I'm going to jump into time capital. And with time capital, we have, all of us are equal. There's no human being that is allowed to stretch a clock, change a clock, buy more time. What we do within the minutes that we have may vary based on the wealth that we have, based on the financial capital that we have. But who is it that is giving the value of time to the family enterprise member that's part of the continuity journey? It's often the spouse. It's often both parents. Same thing with spiritual. I have a client that I worked with yesterday, and he said to me, I really struggle because my wife's the owner of the business, and the business has no spirituality to it. And in our home, we have religion, we have spirituality in terms of humanity and how we think about humanity. And we have a great divide inside of my wife's family business. How do I play a role in bridging that divide that's going on in my wife's family business? And he saw that as spirituality, as an example. Aging, we often see aging as a curse and not a capital. And aging inside of family systems means that there are generations with wisdom who are not exiting a family business, but who are entering the family wisdom bank, if you will. And so oftentimes we see spouses play a role in taking care of our elders, where there's a small group coming together to say, how do we look at aging and family enterprise as a form of capital? And how do we look at influencers to generate wealth out of wisdom and aging? And two of the people on that committee are spouses, and they said, we are the ones who are containing familyness while the elders are aging, and we're raising the generation that's reaching up and grabbing that wisdom and tapping into that wisdom. How do we tap into the aging population to help them create that wealth? And the last two are involvement and commitment. So the family unit, not just the ownership structure that is legal and that is wealth generation generating financially, the family unit, both parents, if there are two parents, or the spousal parent is very committed and involved in getting that next generation to say, where do I fit and belong? And how do I engage in this enterprising family that has ownership? And on the flip side, Paul and my group here, they can put up resistance, right? They can influence that next generation, spouses can influence that next generation to stay as far away from the family business as they can get to avoid the dynamic that that spouse married into. And the last one is legacy. And legacy can be a good word and a bad word. Legacy is one of those words that it is what somebody has done in the course of their lifetime to leave impact, but we don't own our own legacy. Others in our families, others in our communities, they perceive our legacy. We don't prescribe our legacy. And so it is important that as we think about legacy capital inside of enterprising families that want continuity, that are growing, that are 2, 5, 10 generations old, legacy capital is very important. And yet, if I shift my hat to being a spouse in my personal situation, I am the one that runs the legacy committee in my family to say, what did my husband's parents, who are both deceased and died tragically, how do I teach my kids and my nieces and nephews what they need to do to be a part of the future based on learning from the history of their past? So while I am not an owner in my husband's business, I'm not an owner in his family's business, I am an influencer to use that legacy for those that are expected to take over those businesses. So I just want to quickly jump into, I'm going to skip over this because I just spend a lot of time here. This is where the owner spouse rests, whether they have ownership, whether they're active in the business, whether they're on a board, whether they're involved in investments, but we never have a concrete defined role like we do for these others. We know what an owner does. We know what an inheritor does. We know what a trustee does. We know what the founder and the manager and the employee roles are and the board director. We don't have a concrete role definition of owner spouse. And it almost feels like this, that we oftentimes are on this landscape of the family, of the complex enterprising family system by ourselves without knowing what we do and how it's recognized in the greater system. So this is where I want to just call your attention before we transition into Q&A and more the interactive part of it. An owner spouse falls in here, but an owner spouse influence is everywhere on this. So how do we go forward at taking this invisible role and recognizing this invisible power and using it constructively, but putting it on the table? To me, I almost think of it in the same way as conflict. If we hide from conflict, it controls us. When we put conflict on the table, it empowers us. The same thing with this role. When we relegate spouses to the outside of this structure or hidden in this red box invisibly, we as family enterprises lose concept of what kind of power they have. So what can we do to elevate the invisible role and tap into the power constructively? These are some practices that families have identified as roles that their spouse plays. The chief socialization officer, and there's been a lot written about that in the context of gender. And I'm going to take gender and put it in and take it out. So in the context of gender, in more traditional legacy stories, the wives have been the ones who have been the chief socialization officer. Today, almost 2023, we see that we have two working parents in many homes. We have many family businesses being led by women where the husband is the spouse at home. So I'm going to take the wife dynamic out of this, the gender dynamic out of this, and recognize that the spouse that is in the home helping the children go from birth into entry of an enterprise, which may start at five. Some families work from five, getting families members acclimated into the enterprise. It's not just a job in the company. The chief socialization officer, more than what we used to say, the CEO, the chief emotional officer, the spouse's role is not just to make the individual rising in the family, the child, happy. It's to give them tools and resources to rise in society and create impact. And one of the societies is possibly the family enterprise itself. The role of the spouse is also instilling values. Many of you have probably done values exercises inside of your family council or your family business to say, what drives us to make decisions and how does that value come to play? We can see values on line items of financial statements, right? The values are what create the wealth and the wealth capacity. So the spouse plays a role in that. Navigating nuance, and I say nuance because nuance may be that it isn't always bad and it isn't always good. What is coming at the day? The pandemic was an extreme explanation of nuance. It isn't what it was expected on the journey of continuity. But what do owners and managers and family members do? They come home and have the conversation at the dinner table, and that spouse plays a role to navigate that nuance, to know that his wife is angry at her brother and is going to say everything negative possible at dinner, and tomorrow night go to dinner and be very loving and connected with her brother. So the navigation is a key word here. How to do it so that there's constant harmony. Homeostasis is what we call it. The chief homeostasis officer is what another family member calls that. Paul, I see you're laughing at that. You probably can feel that. Conflict, I'm a big fan of conflict. And conflict is how do you give conflict a place at the table? Conflict is a difference of opinion. Sorry for the dog barking in the background. Speaking of conflicting moments, conflict is highly beneficial to the continuity of a business. It means two opinions are in energy with each other. How we manage conflict determines whether it destroys us or elevates us. Often the spouse has that role in the home. And we hear of the term triangulation. And that comes to play as well in that conflict. Developing that next generation, that's that education that we talked about. We have these invisible roles of developing our kids, but yet when they become emerging adults and rising generation, if they are prepared to enter the company inside their minds with their mindset and their attitude, that comes from the nuclear family. That doesn't come from the outside in through a family council or through an education program. That comes from constant reiteration of how do you develop yourself and your identity as a family. Certainly support speaks to itself, that kind of gets into that navigating and managing and developing. I'm going to get to this number seven because it's quite prevalent right now, bridging divides. We are in a world, in America, we just had a midterm election, and every paper around the world talks about the divides, the polarization that we as a country have, but many of our families have it too. And divides are when we begin to create practices and there's space and time in between ourselves and our identity and what we see on the other side, the other. So if you think of the divides, if these are two wide open spaces, a canyon between those that you are trying to unite, family business united, unite and align, there needs, in many situations, the divides are too far apart to come together. And it is often the spouse who becomes the pillar in the middle of the divide, holding up a bridge and inspiring family members to walk that bridge towards the others. And it's different than conflict, right? Conflict is that energy. A divide is just what causes third and fourth and fifth generations to no longer be connected to the enterprise. So that is the bridging of the divides and the building of social connections. How do we, in the effort to walk that bridge, to hold up that bridge and allow, encourage people to walk to the other side, how do we slowly show and build connections that are social, relationships? All of these you can see are the roles that the spouse plays. I have managed conflict twice. I apologize about that. And then encouraging that engagement and inspiring that alignment. So we just integrated those into the other part of it. How are families moving forward to take the invisibility out of it? Defining that role, and I'm curious, and you can put in the Q&A, if any of you have ever defined the role of yourself or your family member as a spouse, what that role is. I read one article, I've researched this topic extensively, and I read one article that was a little bit, it was written recently, but a little bit stale in its perspective because it talked about spouse school, sending them to learn their role in the family. That's not what I mean about defining these roles. I mean, how can families take a look at this and create a concrete role, knowing that none of this can be strong unless the rising generation is supported by all members, including the owner's spouse. Creating a form of measurement. So some families, every family does this differently. Some families say, well, we can't create a monetary measure, contribution measure of a spouse, but what form is it? How might we come together and say, what are the ways that we can measure social impact? What are the ways that we can measure this role of chief socialization officer? What is the just literally in a quantifiable way, how might we say, and one family is trying to do it monetarily, but how might we recognize the contribution of the spouse versus hide the contribution of the spouse? And then another family has a fund. How do they invest in the socio-emotional wealth generation skills? And they have a fund that they actually give to all family units. And they, in that particular family, have the spouses as the caretaker of that fund to say, where are we going to invest resources to further develop those skills, the knowledge, the experiences. One of them has a camp that they do for their family, for the rising gen, for the spouses, for the family members, and for everybody collectively, separate from a family council. So those are just a few ideas just to get the conversation started. So Paul, I think we took that. I'm going to go back up to this. Well, I'm going to stick on this for a moment. So let's make this interactive. I'd like to, that's just my thinking in the role of families, of spouses. When you think about ownership and control, and you think about spouses and the divide that that can cause. Questions, thoughts, interactions?
I've got a raft of questions for you, actually. I was scribbling down lots of questions. It's a really complex scenario, isn't it? The whole concept of define a spouse is a matter of a woman, blended families now, you could have two men together in a relationship. So it's even more complex than it would have been generations ago, although the relationships probably did exist then. But do you see a difference between the role of an owner spouse, so one that actually is married to someone that owns shares in the business, as opposed to maybe the spouse in general, I guess you call them, where you've got a next gen and it's got a spouse, or maybe not quite a spouse, but a long-term relationship where they're having discussions at home? Do you think there are differences between the two?
I think it's evolutionary. And I do, I I don't necessarily think there is a concrete difference. I think the role, the owner spouse has an element of risk because ownership comes with risk, right? The owner spouse has to support the beneficiary, the trust, the ownership, the business, the decision. There's a greater risk that is real and concrete. The partner, the spouse, and I take this definition of spouse in the broadest context.
Yeah.
The person who has influence over the family member that is part of a continuity journey and part of enterprise growth, whether that's an active family member, whether that's a family member that's part of an enterprising family without ownership, that influence is in the mindset, right? Because I think if it's a spouse, a woman called me yesterday and said, my son just got married. I'm about to turn ownership over to him. I don't know what to do to include her. I don't want to include her. I'm not sure what to do in that. Not because I don't like her, but I don't want to burden her. Yet if her son has a future horizon of ownership, the sooner you start, the better. So yes, I see this evolution that as soon as somebody is in the position of influence and invisible power, it's time to engage them on a journey of understanding their partner is involved in an enterprising family, and their partner has to weigh conflict differently and look at decisions differently. Because I was just at a conference where they said the greatest threat to family business continuity is the individuality of family members, whether we agree with that or not. That was John Davis. John Davis is our three circle model founder, right? The individuality is going out and finding your universe and your place in it and how you want to belong to it. If you find a partner to take that journey with you, they can help be that bridge back to the and bridge to also understanding you do have a role in an enterprising family. You just don't cut off and differentiate so much that you have nothing to do with the family enterprise. So yes, did that answer your question?
Yeah, I think it did. It reinforces, doesn't it, the complexity and the difficulty involved. Because the next thought that came into my head was, a lot of families struggle with the whole passing on shares to the next generation and maybe choosing between siblings 1, 2, 3, and 4. And then you bring in the level of spouses. And I think they can get the conversation confused as to whether it's the shares that are being left and the ownerships that's being transitioned or just the role of the influence of the spouse. And so it's an incredibly complex kind of multifaceted kind of equation for families to deal with. It kind of led to the question, do spouses get sufficient airtime in family firms?
It's a great way to ask that question. It depends on the family values, absolutely. And some families don't give them airtime because they don't know how. It never occurred to them. There is some invisible factor that's in play, right? And so some of them absolutely get airtime, but it has to be designed because we're so busy saying we know what the enterprise looks like. Let me come back up to this. We know what the enterprise looks at like. We know the problems coming at us in a business. We need airtime for that. We need airtime for ownership, and I'm going to get to control here in a second. We need airtime to preserve and protect our wealth and the risk that we know we are taking. We have a board and there's a structure to that board. The reason I believe spouses aren't getting the airtime that they deserve is that we're so focused on the gray here. And even if we have a family council and we're focused on the red, we often do it in a prescriptive way, and in a, um, or a, you know, a hat hook way, like we'll give him a little bit of time, but we don't look at the, there's a children's book called Something from Nothing. And on every page, there's two thirds of the page is the story being told. And the bottom third are all these little mice with a whole life and a whole society going on underneath the story that's being told. It's a beautiful children's book about old time Russia. And it reminds me of spouses, right? How do we out the whole universe that's going on and bring it to the table? So those families that are giving spouses airtime often have a spouse's counsel or a partner's counsel so that they can share and communicate, often have a spouse's development program where just like an entrepreneur's organization or a young president's organization where they have an actual regularly scheduled go away and have a retreat with other spouses to get that airtime. And some companies on the other end of the spectrum that don't give spouses airtime and do it on purpose to keep control quickly learn that that rising generation is not excited about coming into responsibility, whether it's stewarding wealth or managing business. And there's this resistance force that comes into play. And so the airtime issue, I think, is evolving. I think we're now realizing that what we don't know, we make up, and that's part of that invisible power. So it's increasing, but not enough in my book.
That leads quite neatly into it. Do you think it's because there's a fear factor? We talk about spouses and we talk about outsiders in the terms of family, but it's almost like a negative force, isn't it? So there's almost an inherent by not recognizing them and not talking about them, it's easier. But then the corollary to that is obviously that they could be a fantastic asset. They could be the best of what they do in terms of they could add real value to your family business. So I guess you kind of have an unknown, but there's the fear of the unknown, and then there's the family keeping it to themselves and not opening the door. So it's tricky, isn't it?
It is tricky. So and there's the hope that we always bring spouses into the family that the family embraces and loves and is comfortable with. There's a reality that the virtue of marriage and now a new nuclear family and a new branch being established can create that divide because now Junior has two perspectives, right? Not just the nuclear family or the lineage family, creating that. And so there is a complexity to integrating spouses because if you have four children and you like the spouses of two or three, but you really don't like one, it's extremely complicated to be fair, right? It's and families strive to be fair and equal. And there are ways to even integrate the disruptive spouse. If that's the case that your family has, and for one family, they liked at the center, I had it in red because that's what they felt they were dealing with is that if they looked at the entire family, there were several players who were married in, who created a dynamic that felt conflictual, and that really became the presenting problem, for many, but she really was evidence of the problem that had been there for a long, long time. Yeah. So we worked with that family to say, how do you onboard spouses and partners in a way that allows them in that family? We actually did a retreat. It was down in Central America. We did a retreat with spouses, and we did a whole section around the power of inquiry. How do you ask questions? How do you encourage each other to ask questions? Because the family members weren't asking questions, but the spouses were encouraging the family members of the next generation to ask the questions. So they're the ones that said, we want to learn how to ask more beautiful questions. There's actually a great book called More Beautiful Question. How do we learn to ask those questions? And how do we give spouses the authority to encourage that questioning versus to hush them up. So that's one idea for your audience to think about.
Because you hear all the stories, don't you, about the negativity of a spouse, of somebody sort of pillow talk, and it becomes an issue and it gets escalated and it's not talked about. So the voice thing, I think, is really important. So anything you can do to educate and inform, to enable them to make informed comment and decisions, I think is, as you say, it's got to be a good thing. I'd be interesting to know how easy you think it is to define the role of a spouse, and then how easy it is to define a measurement tool that could be applied broadly to the family business community as a whole in terms of the contribution. Because I know you talked earlier about the socioeconomic and the values and the creation, all those softer skills and soft, which are fantastic and very much the essence of what family firms are. But it's a difficult question. How do you define a measurement framework?
It is complex, but if you just start in thinking about, you know, what I've encouraged families to do is, one is to take a look at journaling the course. One family did a week, one did 30 days, one did 90 days, and one's done, they're on the journey for a year. To journal at the end of the day, in what way did your effect of the day, did your role of the day help contribute to how your family defines enterprising? Mm-hmm. What did you do? Did you drive your child to the theater program that he or she is in? And what does that have to do with being enterprising? Did you take them on an experiential learning outing? And in what way does that contribute back? So just looking generically, broadly, journaling, what is it that you do that influences enterprising your family? And then what is it that you do that influences decision-making in your family? What is it that you do that influences generating the capital in your family? And how much time do you spend in the course of your day doing that, right? What is that? Because there's no, when you go into the business, if you're the chief, everybody knows what you do. Mm-hmm. When you go into the family, if you're the chief, not everybody knows what you do. In one family that I worked with, they actually had the rising gen help create that job description. What is it that, in this case, it was the mom, what is it that mom does relative to preparing us to be good stewards of this fourth generation family business? And that helped. Once they created that framework, they were able to say, you know, you spend a lot of your time each day grooming us. What if you also then pursued this learning opportunity so you knew how to groom us more? The dad was in YPO, Young Presidents Organization, and the daughter wanted the mom to go through some program like that. And she went through a program in the United States that I think is also international, called the Hoffman Institute. Mm-hmm. How do you lead family? And so that's how they define their role. It's not that it's easy, but until it's done, the role remains invisible. And the power and influence remains peripheral.
Yeah, no, I get that completely. And I think you're totally, totally agree with you. I just see some difficult conversations because it's not something that's actively talked about or openly talked about in family business communities. So there's not a book on the shelf. And most family business topics, there's not a book to take off a shelf. But this is one of those that's so remote or so distant and difficult, and people are probably scared of opening up maybe a can of worms. That it becomes one of those that's just easier not to open and not to have the conversation. But there's huge value, isn't there, in actually turning it around and making it a positive and actually recognizing the contribution.
Sure. And oftentimes where it starts is in this family council environment, is in the family council to say, how do we bring to life our vision and mission and values as a family and our vision and mission and values as an enterprise? And in the family council, that's often where it's stated, you know, who a map of influence pockets, right? And then that immediately surfaces the role of that, or the influence of the spouse. And then how intentional do we want to be about engaging the spouses? And one topic we haven't touched on that leads into that, the partner who becomes a spouse, is the prenuptial agreement. Yeah. And so often in the family council, or the family constitution, there is a mandate that there be a premarital or pre-commitment contract, what we often call a prenuptial agreement. And in that prenuptial agreement, what some families have done is created a learning academy, if you will, that says, we want to make sure that as you enter our family space, what we did in one learning academy is we had a track on explaining ownership, because owners don't understand ownership. So how might spouses understand ownership if the owner that he or she is marrying or partnering with doesn't understand it? So we created a track on what ownership means. And inside of that track, we included in their family, they had trust. That trust, if your spouse is inheriting wealth or from a trust, your spouse is a beneficiary, the trustee owns the decision-making. So we explain that so that the incoming support person, partner, can understand that maybe their spouse doesn't understand ownership, right? We just had one blow up in a family where they didn't get that piece of it. And the spouse is the one that helped the family members say, you're confused about your role. And then the same thing, explaining what is the business. Many spouses or partners that come in don't even understand what is top line, what is bottom line. They just hear their partner come home and say, we're a 100 million pound business, but what does that mean to the bottom line? Because you're asking me to spend no money. Right. Yeah. So on our personal budget. So we did a track on that. We did a track on governance. What does that mean? And then we did a track on this wealth. And then for that family, they chose to do a track on social impact. And we added that track because the person marrying in ran was an executive director of a nonprofit that was very much focused on sustainability. And they knew the reverse influence was coming in. So they did a track on that for spouses, and then also did a separate track on that for the whole family relative to how this person is going to influence our decision-making.
Yeah, I can see, listening to you now, it kind of, there's a crystallization or kind of a light bulb, but there's definitely an educational piece, isn't there, in terms of the spouse. We talk about next generation and going on courses to become a responsible owner or a responsible steward of a business, but actually, that could so easily be subjugated down into the same thing, but for a spouse coming in to understand what the values are, what the history is, and just like an induction program to induct them into something they've married into, which is a big piece of what's going to be their life going forward. So I think education's got a big role.
It's a very big, and I think, you know, if this title could also say the learning organization family, right? And it would give you all of your areas that you need to create those learning opportunities. And if a spouse isn't aware or a partner isn't aware of all of these nuanced complexities, the word complex is up there. If you don't educate to the complexities, and every line item up here becomes its own curriculum, if you will, if you're looking for a curriculum checklist, this is it. Then how can that person bridge divides, and how can that person support a descending family member that's a future or current owner that is responsible for stewardship?
Totally agree with you. I think it's what you're talking about is something that's been around for generations. People have had partners and spouses since the day that Earth was formed, but it's not been talked about in the way that you've opened up today in terms of sharing some of your knowledge, Kim. So that's been really fascinating for me. And I've just got one last question I'd like to pose to you just before we close.
Sure. And then I have one for you.
So, I do? Yeah. I'm nervous now. If you could give one piece of advice to the people out there listening today in terms of talking to their clients or as a next generation member, married or soon to be married, what piece of advice would you give them in order just to really understand the situation that their spouse is about to or has just stepped into? What should they think about if they've done nothing before, never really thought about it? What advice would you give to them to take away today?
I would say, I would say for families, if they're about to step into it, I would say if they haven't created a genogram, do you know what a genogram is?
Yeah.
So if they haven't created that chart that says, let's go back a few generations and see in our family structure how we got together. And let's go back and see who all played a role, and everyone will have played a role in getting us to the moment we're in today, and who across the here and now plays a role in presenting this future generations and the current generations with the opportunity to elevate this enterprise and elevate this family. So that's how I would start, is to say, looking at the family construct, looking at the legacy history, looking at, then I would go through and go through this and create a checklist. How would we define our wealth in each of these areas?
Yeah.
And who is going to generate capacity and skill of the people who are stewarding and increasing the value of all of these different kinds of capital that will make us successful today and into the future, and that did make us successful from inception to now. And that's the piece of advice I would give them to get started on understanding who that is and how spouses and partners do influence the direction of the enterprising family and the direction of the family enterprise itself, the business itself.
Yeah, that's really good advice. And it's a part of the family business bit that I really enjoy, is the narrative and the history that defines who they are today, but will shape who they become tomorrow. So the narrative is a great place to start.
Sure. And my question to you, Paul, is what about the topic of spouses in family enterprise was intriguing to you? And why did you add it to this particular curriculum? And how do you see it fitting in to the other topics that you've offered?
Yeah, we've done the global summit really on the back of COVID. So it gave us an opportunity to bring our global community together. And I've been in the field now probably for 25 years and been to lots of seminars and heard lots and lots of similar topics around governance and succession and ownership and legacy. And actually, I always want to challenge myself in terms of learning, and I want to be able to put out to our community different things to raise awareness and actually start conversations. And I think the role of spouses has been underplayed for a long time. It's not on very many agendas at very many conferences, and for me, I just thought it was different, and I'm always prepared to push the boundaries to give people opportunity to listen and learn, and I think that's what we need to do in this space. So for me this year, we picked on the quest for legitimacy on Monday with Jamie and Russ, just to look at the next gen in a very different way on their journey, and the spousal question really fitted that model too, in terms of just challenging the audience to think and listen and learn. And I have to say, I've listened and learned a lot this week as well. So that's why it's in the program.
Sure. And just to tie this in, you mentioned Jamie and Russ. The shadow is cast also by the spouse and the mom or the dad who isn't active in this, in the gray parts of this gold band. But that shadow is cast broadly by all players who become the giants in the land that we live in. They talked about the land of giants, and the quest for legitimacy, the word quest, usually the initiative to be on the quest comes from the parent that's not active in the enterprise. So,
we've got a circle. So that's fantastic and good to know. And it makes sense. It clearly makes sense that those individuals that are driven on their own quest and can make their own decisions have been given that power of decision-making by the way they've been brought up and the values they've been living with throughout the time they've been on the planet. So it's really lovely when the bits come together, but I have to say, I can't take credit for that. That happened probably by default, but no, it's just a learning. It's a learning opportunity for all of us. And I thank you so much for your time today. It's been fascinating listening to you. So Kim, thank you so much.
And thanks to everyone. Thank you, Paul. And I wish you all well on this learning journey.
Thank you, Kim.
All right. Take care.